Days, then make weeks, then months of dawns of hope and sunsets of despair, living amidst the sunlight of victories and the gray skies of discontent. But the moments that will one day matter when we look over the shoulder of our past are those when we conquered our fears, stood our ground, sacrificed for someone we loved, and stood up for the rights of a perfect stranger because it was the right and righteous thing to do. I was born deep in the Alabama Black Belt, 21 miles west of the Georgia state line. My mother, Lurleen, was a housewife, and my father, George, was a lawyer. We lived next to the grammar school in a white wood-framed house with a wide front porch that sat in the shade of water oaks and pecan trees. In the light of summer sunsets, my mother would sit in the backyard with her friends while we played outside. And on Friday nights, my father and I would watch boxing matches on TV and cheer for the underdog. I lived amidst the crooks and crannies of happiness, lying in the backyards of my childhood, looking for faces in the clouds of contentment that floated by. It was a place to shelter from storms of discontent and have hopes for the future. It was where my mother stood by the door or pulled back the curtains in the dark of night to watch for me coming home. It was a place you could dream of returning to one day to capture the past, to tell stories to your grandchildren of the way life used to be. But for the cause of segregation, there were no hugs and kisses, no going away gifts or parties, and no opportunities to say goodbye to my childhood when we left our home in Clayton when I was 11 years old. But we packed our clothes, turned off the lights, and my father locked the kitchen door behind us. If my mother had told me we were never coming back, perhaps I would have looked harder or faster at the places we passed by that could have reminded me of what my life had been like. There was never an inkling of what was to come. From that moment on, our lives were hitched to an ascending star of power, where the past didn't matter, when there was so much to gain in the days that lay ahead. When the house on New Falls Street was destroyed by fire several years later, it was as if it was a warning to never look back. There would be no place to take my sons to show them what happiness me had looked like. And, but for the memories, there were no mementos or crinkled up photos to share with them. I was 12 years old when my father was inaugurated as governor and proclaimed, segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever. I was 13 when he stood in the schoolhouse door. I was 15 when John Lewis, Amelia Borden, and others were attacked and beaten on the Edmund Pettus Bridge in March of 1965, the same year that my father failed in an attempt to pass a constitutional amendment that would allow him to run for a second term. I was 16 years old when I told my mother I wanted her to share her time with me rather than run for governor herself. But the week before I turned 17, I stood beneath the winter sky and heard the roars of approval as Lurleen Burns Wallace was inaugurated as governor of Alabama. On May 7th, 1968, 2 weeks before I graduated from high school, my mother died at home in the Alabama Governor's Mansion at the age of 41. Thousands of Alabamians stood in line for hours in the downtown streets of Montgomery waiting to pay their last respects to my mother and their governor as she lay in state in the rotunda of the Alabama Capitol. That summer, I traveled with the Wallace presidential campaign to stand by my father on rally stages through America's Rust Belt and on to states in New England. I watched and listened as working class men and women roared their approval at the notion of a more conservative country where true American patriots would once again be in charge. And I heard the rising choruses of discontent from angry demonstrators that pushed their way inside. Nighttime rallies often became angry mobs of supporters fighting with protesters, heaving chairs at one another, and throwing things at us as we stood in front of large banners that read, "Stand Up for America," on the stage. On the night of July the 26th, the crowd was both large and anxious as protesters unrolled banners and began to chant during a campaign rally on the outskirts of Providence, Rhode Island. Amid fits of anger and roars of approval, fights broke out as my father called protesters pointy-headed liberals who wanted to run everything. After the rally, security guards helped me escape from an angry mob and into my father's car. The dress that my mother had once bought for me was covered with black spray paint and ink. A woman came up to the front passenger window and began beating on the glass with a leg from a metal folding chair. And then she was gone, fallen back and away into crowds of fury. I used to think about the woman who came to the window. I wondered if she had children. And I wondered what she would have done to me if I had rolled down the window. For many years, there was no moving on beyond the politics of my life, for it would be my constant companion for another 31 years. I walked among the lives of others, but never on my own. People saw me for who I belonged to rather than who I was, and living a life of quiet indifference sheltered me from the storm. My hopes and dreams were lost along the roadways of looking over my shoulder to a past that would define my future. But today, and for all the tomorrows in my life, I speak to you in my own voice and from my own heart, and for the benefit of truth and for the legacy that I will one day leave to my own two sons. The America of today has returned to the past in order to define our future, rather than in an America that looks forward and fosters dreams of what we can become. But for the tomorrows in all of your lives, I challenge you to stand and to proclaim that when we say all men are created equal, it means something, protects something, and encourages us to believe that the diversity among us has little to do with equality and has everything to do with strength of character and country. For it is in honor of the sacrifice of others and in better hopes for a more just America that we must declare that our nation is at its best when she embraces all of us, protects the least of us, and offers her bounty of hope and prosperity to not just some of us. And in the spirit of all those men, women, and children who have walked along the blacktop roads of history for the sake of the American promise, let us raise the call for justice in our lifetimes. For it is in the circle of brotherhood and understanding that America has and can celebrate its finest moments. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. That is the promise of the America that men and women long for, that our sons and daughters fight for, and what our sense of morality stands for. It is the American dream that gives rise to heartfelt moments, that encourages us to believe that each of us have a personal obligation to live in the present and work each day for the promise of a more just America, where life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness is not just something to dream, it is something to live in. In the American South of the 1960s and today, throughout our nation, there are men and women of power who believe that there's gallantry in wrongdoing, in demeaning the humanity of others, and laying waste to the American dream as long as there are armies of angry mobs behind them and self-righteous mobs standing beside them. But then again, there are those of us who believe that America is at her best when she embraces all of us, protects the least of us, and offers her bounty of hope and prosperity to not just some of us. And for today and for all of our tomorrows, we must constantly remind others that we can neither afford nor should we be required to live in the past. There's no better time than now for true American patriots to stand up for the rights of others and proclaim that the diversity among us is what has made and will always make America a greater nation. Each of us can live our lives with inspiration, always aspiring to make the choices that lead us to higher ground, that guides us to understanding a purpose of just not who we are, but who we can become. And let us promote the notion that a person's leadership should not be measured by the power he has, but rather by the people he empowers. While it should never be difficult to promote the cause of liberty, some of the greatest moments in the history of America have occurred when crisis has overcome complacency and someone challenges others to stand with them. For it is through the brotherhood and sisterhood of understanding that all lives matter that can encourage each of us to join hands with others to claim victories of our own. On August 28, 1963, Dr. Martin Luther King stood on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial and spoke to the heart of America. It was one of his finest moments. It was the day he told America he had a dream. In that speech he said, I have a dream that one day down in Alabama, with this vicious racist, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right down there in Alabama, little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. On the 50th anniversary of the Selma to Montgomery March, as Bernice King and I stood holding hands in front of the Alabama State Capitol, I could not help but wonder how the course of history may have changed if Dr. King and Governor Wallace could only have known that one day down in Alabama, the little black girl and the little white girl holding hands would be their own daughters. I hope that there will be moments in each of your lives where the future can become more important than the past, where I shall overcome becomes I have overcome, when you can stand firm for freedom when all others pass away, be courageous and proclaim victories of your own. Rise up for yourselves and for your dignity so that one day, right down here in Alabama, your daughters and sons will have the courage to stand up and speak out for you, because of you, and in honor of you. Now is the time that we must hold hands rather than holding down the inherent rights of others. For no one can ever measure the true worth of a mended heart that beats because someone cared. We cannot expect the next generation of Americans to do something to change the world if we aspire to do nothing to protect liberty and recognize our individual obligations to service. How can we teach future generations about positive social change if we see injustice and turn our backs? For injustice knows no death. It rises like a dark mist on the horizon, laying low in the hearts of those who are unwilling to accept the notion of unconditional love. And while there will be times in our lives when we cannot change the direction of the wind, there will always be opportunities for each of us to adjust our sails for a more just America. For there are lessons to be learned along the roadways that others have traveled in pursuit of their dreams of enjoying the full measure of equality. There are great moments in history when men, women, and children stood their ground for the rights that were guaranteed to them. And today is the time when all Americans should fulfill the promise they pledge each time the American flag goes by. There should never be a bad time for us to engage in acts of public service that create opportunities for enlightenment and change. For again, we cannot expect the next generation of Americans to do something to change the world if we do nothing to recognize our obligations to service. For it was in that character and in the belief of the American promise that all men are created equal, that African American men, women, and children in Montgomery stood up for themselves and sang, "Well, the only chains we can stand are the chains of hand in hand. Keep your eyes on the prize, hold on." The mothers, daughters, fathers, and sons of the Civil Rights Movement never wavered in their belief that justice would come, and they prayed for the day when the fair winds of freedom and following seas would carry them to the shores of a life without fear and a heart of purpose. Their hopes, their dreams, and their service made them giants of their generation, and their courage and determination should inspire us to find our own moments of opportunity that can lead to hope rather than to roadways of shattered dreams that always lead back to where we started. Their grace in the midst of hate should inspire us to believe that there's dignity in demanding that all of us deserve the full measure of justice and mercy under the law. Their courage should harness the power in each of us to reach, to believe, and stand firm in the belief that all of our lives count for something. And their stories inspire others to believe that even in the midst of despair lies the power to overcome. For it was through their own lives that the heroes of the civil rights movement came to understand that what you stand for in your life is not as important as what you do in your life, and it is the act of doing that unleashes the power of your spirit. And in their honor, let us remain true to the better part of our individual humanity, where empathy, morality, and love reside. As a child, I rode on the wings of the politics of hate and fear, as it carried me away from my childhood and conquered my dream of a simple life. But through it all, I never lost faith in the hope that one day my life would count for something. And for all of your tomorrows, I hope that each of you can live your life among moments of who you are rather than who you belong to. I encourage you to stand up rather than stand by for liberty and justice for all. And I pray that all of us can find the hope of peace and promise in the words, "We shall overcome." Thank you very much.